What's happening, everyone? This is Michael yet again. Thanks for joining me. I was just thinking about, you know, round objects, balls, the earth, the spiral, you know, things that go round and round, and where they stop, everybody knows. Hollywood. Wow. A slew and a slew of bad exorcism films out there. You've seen them. A lot of bad exorcism films. And this is all they could come up with. Now, of course, everyone, I'm speaking of the Exorcist Believer. I got a question, ladies and gentlemen. Now, you probably felt this way before, or you've questioned yourself before, asked yourself this question in your mind. You ever like watch a film and you know you're in and out, fair to meddling, you're not really, you know, into it a whole bunch, but you're there. And after the film ends, you just kind of ask yourself, was this film really necessary? Well, that's what I asked myself after watching this film. Was it really necessary? And the resounding answer is no. The Exorcist Believer is a film that brought nothing new to the table. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. I've seen about two exorcism films this year, and I gotta say that those were better than this. And as a matter of fact, this film really strikes me as a movie that really didn't try very hard. And it's a movie that obviously is making money off of the current trend to bring back franchises, wash, rinse, and repeat. The same thing over and over and over. But what gets me more than anything, and what's frustrating about the whole thing to me, is the fact that audiences keep making these mediocre films a success. I mean, if you think about this movie, as dull as this movie is, as uninspired as this movie is, as marginal as this movie is, it had a production budget of about $30 million and it has grossed $135 million. I mean, you know, they say that a film has to make three times its budget to be considered a success. Well, this film has done that, and it's probably began eating into its promotional cost as well. Now, we're not even talking about home streaming and physical media releases and all that. So the film will turn a profit and there will be sequels. As a matter of fact, this is the first film in a trilogy of movies. And I can only imagine by current trends and the way the audience seems to support these films is that the other films will probably be more successful. Now, with that said, guys, you know, I don't know what it is about the current trend in moviegoers. I mean, this is something that I talk about all the time. Wash, rinse, and repeat. We've got the Halloween film still hanging around. We've got the Texas Chainsaw Massacre film still here. We've got the Scream film still here. It's everything that's old is new now. We're still making money off these old franchises. And if you have any ideas for something new, it most likely is going to fail. Now, you know, audiences. I don't get audiences. I don't understand why audiences support these mediocre films. Are they that damn desperate for horror? Kind of reminds me, guys. Reminds me of something. Like, when I was in school, part of a team in sports or something, you won, or if you're, you know, you win something by yourself, you got a first place trophy. You got an award. And by today's standards, if someone loses, they still get an award. So is that the mindset of moviegoers now? Do they look at a film that's not that good and say, well, yeah, the film wasn't that good, but we got to give him credit for making it. I mean, is that the mindset now? I just don't understand how all these mediocre films become a success. The Exorcist Believer is a marginal, very marginal film, and it's got $135 million? I don't get it. I just do not get it. this is a film that, you know, like I said, current trends is obviously made to capitalize on the name Exorcist. And that's what they did. They set out to make money off of that franchise. Now, this is a film, guys, that, you know, offers nothing new. It brings nothing new to the table. There's no originality in it. It's the same old thing we've seen a long time. And, you know, some people will say, well, at least they took the time to develop the characters. Really? Really? What characters? What characters exactly did they develop? I'll wait. Well, yeah, they did kind of develop Leslie Odom's character. That was a dad in this who lost his wife at the beginning of the film. He's probably the most developed character in the whole film as he is the star and the focus of the film. And, you know, he has a lack of faith due to the fact that his wife, who was pregnant while they were on vacation, and why would you even take your wife as big and as it looked like she was going to be due any time? Why would you even take her overseas for a vacation when, you know, her baby could come anytime? I didn't even get that whole thing. But anyway, he's the one that's developed. And when he loses his wife, of course, he loses his faith. And that's a central theme in all the Exorcist films. There's always a central character that is questioning or having trouble with his faith. What I'm really surprised about is that in this current day and age, I'm surprised the roles weren't reversed and that there was a mother and the little boy was possessed. But, you know, central theme, guys, the lead character is always questioning his faith. That's the same thing with Leslie Odom. He's questioning his faith. His daughter, I mean, we see this opening 13 years ago, and then we see present day where he's raised a daughter, the daughter's born. And through this ritual, the daughter has this girl at school. They go out in the forest, and the daughter wants to communicate with her mom, who's dead. And they open up this pathway, this opening, and they try to communicate with the mom, and they end up letting demons in. I'm assuming, I don't know, is it the same demon that's possessing both girls or not? But I don't know. And at this point, I really don't care. Okay, so after they open up this pathway to the spirit world and become demonized, demonized, this is one hell of a demon. He possesses two chicks at the same time. You can see him talking to the other demons. Hey, yeah, you want me to tell you something, man, that's really supernatural? I actually did these two girls at the same time. Get out of here. Fuck out of here with that shit. But anyway, the girls end up disappearing for 3 days. And the father of the little black girl goes to the cops and he goes to the other family. And he asks the other family, hey, is there anything your kid might have been doing that we need to know about? And I'm thinking, Dad, what are you getting at? Do you think their little kid is, what, a lesbian and she captured her for a lesbian imprisonment or something? What the hell are you talking about? Kind of a strange question to me. I mean, it's like, if we knew our kid was kind of weird, we probably wouldn't let her hang around other kids, okay? So anyway, they go out in the woods and search for their kids. And the father that I mentioned earlier with the black daughter, he goes to this tunnel and he starts getting these supernatural vibes. Something he senses in this tunnel. And I'm thinking, well, maybe the girls were in this tunnel at one time, but I guess there's some leftover demonic residual energy, or simply maybe the demon just shit and the shit is in the tunnel and he's smelling it. But anyway, because I smelled it the entire time I watched the movie. But anyway, that goes on and they don't find the little girls. And he's, you know, they're both sticking up posters on trees and on posts and everything saying, you know, their daughters are missing and everything. And there's some kind of like adversarial thing going on between both dads because both of them are kind of blaming the other dad for the disappearance of their kid and so on and so forth. But they do find the girls 2 days later in a barn. A farmer finds them in his barn. They're sitting like in a stall all hugged up and looking all scared. And I'm thinking, what the fuck are they doing in a barn? I mean, apparently when he finds them, they are of their right mind. So wouldn't they still go home? Because when they get to the hospital, all they cry about to their parents is, I want to go home. I want to go home. I want to go home. So you mean to tell me this fucking demon is so fucking stupid that he can't possess them and just make them go home or let them go home? I mean, why are you sitting them in a barn, you idiot demon? But, you know, from that point on, we have just a mediocre show of demonic things we've seen in every film. You know, the loud talking, the cursing, the scars on the body. I mean, if you've seen any other Exorcist film, you've seen this one, as this one brings nothing new to the table. And the only thing that I would say that's interesting about this film is that in many of the Exorcist films, we have a central character who is a force of good. This character is essentially the character that fights off evil and that character that has been anointed by God. And when I say interesting in terms of this movie, and believe me, there's very little to be interested in this movie, but one of the interesting themes that they throw around is a subplot about, you know, we don't need a priest. Because there's not really a central priest character in this. There is a priest, but he's not really a part of the exorcism. And when he does decide to step in, he's quickly dispatched like the little bitch he is in this film. I mean, this is most likely one of the worst priests I've ever seen in an Exorcist movie. I mean, I thought Richard Burton from The Exorcist 2 was bad. This guy makes him look like he's standing on Mount Everest shaking hands with Noah. Lousy priest character. Lousy. And we don't spend any time with this priest character at all, so we don't get to know him. And really, when he does bite the dust, there's no feelings about it. We don't feel sad. We don't feel upset. And it's just a damn shame, really. A waste of a character. I don't even know why he was in the damn film. And as a matter of fact, this priest is so lousy that when one of the characters asks him for help, you know what he does? He gives her, ultimately, he gives her the book and says, here, this is what you need to do. You don't need me. You know, do it on your own. I can't do it. I can't get involved. No, I'm not going to do it. I've talked to my bosses and they all say, no, we can't do it. And I'm just thinking, you've seen the evidence. You know that the girls are possessed. And even with that knowledge, despite the fact that your organization is saying, don't fucking lay hands on it, you just walk away. And that's what he does basically in the movie. Now, he does come back later to try to help, but like I said, he gets dispatched real easy. And I'm just like, boy, I miss the good old days. Father Marin, Father Karras, I mean, these were characters you could get behind. But this film pretty much rejects the formula of the other Exorcist films in that we don't need a priest. We don't need religion. All we need is community coming together. Now, I'm saying that's kind of an interesting subplot there. And not interesting in the way that, oh, I think this is great. This is wonderful. This is marvelous. Basically, it's throwing out religion. And, you know, maybe I can understand that because religion has got a lot of people in a lot of trouble. I mean, there's been some bad decisions made in the wake of religion. So maybe the filmmakers were consciously saying something here. But the thing is, when you take kind of this unique premise where you say, no, we don't need a priest to exorcise the demon. We can let the community do it. The community can come together. It's like, hey, Bob, how are you? I'm not doing so good, man. My fucking daughter, she's possessed. I'm going to call my pastor. Oh, no, man, no, no. Me, you, Phil, and I'll get a few of my other drinking buddies, and we'll knock that devil right out of her. We can do it. We don't need a priest. We don't need any religion. Let's do it ourselves. So, yeah, I think that's an interesting idea to say that, you know, basically every one of us has the power of God in us, and we can just get rid of the demons ourselves. But I don't like that theory. I don't like that representation in the film because I feel like it's just more dramatic in terms of a film when you have this force of good from God versus this force of evil from the devil. I mean, you know, good and evil, Lucifer, God. I mean, that's just how it is. And there's never really a melding of the mind, so to speak, when these people come together. It's never really a convincing state of affairs because, I mean, it's too easy.
There's no time spent on it. There's no development given to these different religions actually working together. I mean, it's like if you have a Christian here and a Muslim here, they're not fixing to agree, man.
And I thought that was interesting in that it seems like today in religion, all we ever freaking hear about is how this religion says, no, I'm right. You're not getting to heaven without going this way. No, no, you need to do this. It won't work if you don't follow my religion. It's like every religion is adversarial. They're against each other. They think that they're the only way. But in this film, which preaches community and people coming together, we have no conflict between the religions. And I just kind of thought, that's really kind of unbelievable. Unfreaking believable. Because if we really had a child that was possessed and you have, say, a Muslim here and a Christian here, I'm pretty damn sure that in today's age, they're not fixing to come together and do a baptism. No. And if they do, it's not going to be just a meet me at Fred's house and we'll get started. There's going to be a conflict there. There's going to be some discussion there. There's probably going to be some arguments there. But, you know, that's one of the most interesting things about this film in that it wants to make a movie about community instead of religion, instead of priests coming together. It's more or less pushing the religious aspect of exorcisms out the door and then saying community can do it. And this is the way, the point of the movie, this is what it's saying. And then they wrap no additional story around that whole source of difference to make it stand out or to focus on it or to show that the film considers this a very valid and important thing to do. So they don't bring any attention to it at all. No attention to this theme of community, just coming together and that's all you need. But no, that's stupid. That's just stupid. It's just like, you know, if you're going to say in an exorcism movie that we don't need a priest, then you need to focus on what you're saying we do need. Tell us why we need this. Tell us why this works. Tell us everything in detail about it, not just kind of gloss over it and say, well, yeah, people coming together is what the way we could solve the problems of the world and so on and so forth. But yeah, guys, this film, they even brought back Ellen Burstyn. And this, of course, is the actress that played the mom in the original film. She's an old lady now. She's probably about 150 in this movie. And, you know, the father who has no faith, who doesn't have any belief that his daughter has been possessed, you know, eventually he comes to terms with it and realizes something's wrong with her. So he turns to Ellen Burstyn's character and asks for help. Apparently she's this author who's written a book about her daughter. And this has caused a rift between her and her daughter. When she wrote this book, her daughter was like, fuck this. I don't want my whole story out in the public. I'm leaving. So she hasn't seen her daughter. But anyway, Ellen Burstyn goes to our lead character's house to get a look at the daughter. And, you know, after introducing this character, you're thinking, well, yeah, this is kind of cool. They brought back the original mom character. Within 10 minutes of her appearance, she goes to the girls to his house. She didn't go to Leslie Odom's home. She went to the other couple's home. And, you know, the house is in a shambles. The father is sitting in there on the floor. And I'm just thinking, you know, this guy is a devout Christian. This family with the other girl, they're devout Christians. They take their daughter to the church and so on and so forth. And, you know, he's in there when they go in there. He's sitting in there on the kitchen floor just like, you know, God is punishing me. God is punishing me. Whereas, you know, any normal Christian person with half a brain would be like, my daughter's been infected with the evil of the devil. We have to fight against this. You know, it's like when the shit goes to hell, his fucking faith just goes to hell. He's sitting on the floor crying. God is punishing him. And I'm like thinking, punishing you for what, dude? What did you do? Did you do something in this film that we don't know about? Why are you laying there crying, all falling apart? Which, in narrative terms, didn't make any sense to me. Because why do you have a character that's just sitting here on the floor, who we've seen from the very beginning, a very avid church goer, strong in his faith. And then all of a sudden this happens. He's sitting on the floor crying. And you got to think, What did you do? What skeletons do you have in your closet? Why do you think you have the need? What did you do to be punished like this? We don't learn anything about this. I mean, we can just assume that the guy just broke down. And then you're thinking, well, I guess he wasn't very strong in faith to begin with. You know, instead of praying to your God and asking for help or asking for strength, you're on the floor crying like a fucking toddler. But anyway, they go in the house, you know. Leslie Odom's character's looking around at everybody, talking to the people that's there, searching for people. And Ellen Burstyn's character takes it upon herself. She hears something upstairs to go check on the kid herself. And why she does this, I do not know. I'm thinking, do you not realize how freaking old you are? You're 250 years old. Why are you going up in this damn room to confront this evil that you've seen and knows exists because you dealt with it before? You couldn't do shit about it when you were younger. Why do you think you can do something now that you're 350 years old? So she goes upstairs and talks to the demon and tells the demon, I know who you are, which immediately made me think, so is this the same demon that was in her daughter? But, you know, it's not. It's a totally different demon. So how does she know who this demon is? I don't know. But at any rate, guys, demon ends up attacking her, gouging her eyes out with a cross, blinds her, just gouged her eyes out. And I could not help but think, you mean to tell me you got Ellen Burstyn, who's 450 years old now, you mean to tell me you got her to star, make an appearance in this film just to gouge her eyes out? Really? What fucking sense does that make? So she gets her eyes gouged out, goes to the hospital, and then we see her, you know, wrapped up with things over her eyes, and the film cuts back and forth to her every now and then when they're doing the exorcism. It's like she can feel what's going on. And the fact that this isn't the same demon that plagued her and her daughter, how she have some kind of connection to it is beyond me. Now, it would have made more sense to me if it was the same demon. Then you could understand the connection and the line, I know you, and all this kind of stuff. But it's a whole different demon, so I don't know what the fuck that means. But anyway, maybe the sequels will tell. Anyway, you know, these group of people, they all get together, you know, all these different identities, these different religions, and they're trying to exorcise this demon. And, you know, throughout the whole film, Leslie Odom's character is going through this thing where he doesn't believe. He puts down people who talk about religion. Basically, he ridicules them. Ridicules them and so on and so forth. And, you know, at the end of the day, he ends up getting his faith back. And that seems to be what pulls the devil out of his kid and the other little girl, although the other little girl does not make it. Now,
you're looking at just your basic run-of-the-mill generic horror films with a lot of weird things happen that are pretty much unexplainable. I mean, for instance, there's a scene in the film where, you know, after our lead character is coming home from trying to find his daughter, he's looked everywhere, he's exhausted, he's tired. He comes home and the door to his house, the front door is open. And so, you know, he thinks what probably any parent would think. He probably thinks his kid came home. So he rushes in the house and his freaking neighbors are having these people come over to his house and they're like treating the house for spirits or whatever the hell they were doing, but they just left the front door open. And my first thought was, why the hell would you go over to someone's house unannounced, just walk into their house and treat their house for bad spirits or good luck or good faith or whatever the fuck ever? Why would you do that without their permission? Why would you do that and leave their front door wide open? And one other thing, how the fuck did you get in? So I don't, just some weird things going on here. And another thing that's kind of annoying to me is that when they find these girls, they're all in the freaking hospital being checked out. I mean, you got people taking pictures of the wounds on them. Their fingernails are missing. Their toes are fucked up. They look like they fucking walked 300 miles. Anyway, I mean, the kids, they both have these blank stares. Like, they're just sitting up on the examination table like this. And they're moving like this. And the parents fail to see anything fucking wrong with these kids. And when they take them home, they're acting the same way with these dead eyes and they're just barely moving. And I mean, you think, do you fucking parents know anything about your own fucking kids? I mean, how can you not tell that there's something wrong, seriously wrong with these freaking kids? They're acting like fucking zombies. But anyway, I just thought that was kind of annoying, guys, in that, you know, your parents, these are your kids. You should know your kids better than this, right?
I said it at the beginning of this video, guys. This film just offers nothing new. Nothing new to the table. And it's just a movie that is, it's just there. It's just there. I can't think of anything that's really memorable in this movie. It's just a movie that has pretty paint-by-the-numbers characters. You can tell they tried to add a bit of depth to these people, but in terms of who these people were, the only one that stayed consistent was Leslie Odom's character, the dad. The religious couple, you know, when shit got going, when shit hit them in the face, you know, their faith meant absolutely nothing to them. I don't know if that was a conscious decision made by the filmmakers. Maybe he's, you know, they're trying to cut out religion completely. So maybe he thought, well, yeah, you know, here are my Christian characters. So when shit goes to hell, let's just make them worthless. Let's just make their God worthless. Don't mean nothing. So I don't know if that was a conscious thing they did there. But uninteresting characters. These little girls, you never once feel like, you know, they're, you know, for me personally, when Linda Blair was going through this, little Reagan, I felt bad for her. I wanted her to be exercised. I wanted things to work out. But these characters did not have the ability to make me feel that way. And I think a lot of it was due to the fact that you don't really spend much time with these girls to actually get a handle on who they are, their personalities. I mean, we see Leslie Odom's character, his daughter at the beginning, who's looking at pictures of her mom and all that, but that's just not enough to connect you to the character. There needed to be a connection point to where we felt connected to this character and felt, you know, the plight she was going through and felt badly for her. You know, oftentimes in films, when it comes to kids, we don't need that additional work because, you know, I think that filmmakers say, well, it's a kid, so, you know, they're automatically going to feel sympathy for a kid. And it did not work that way in this film. It's like they only spent like maybe 15, 20 minutes setting up this kid character. And in that time, there's not really much time spent on her actually being this character. She's more or less just a predictable little plot point where, you know, she plays games with her dad, they laugh, he cooks her breakfast, but that's it. We don't really see anything that should connect us to her and make us feel really sympathy for what she's going through. I never felt that for these girls. And I think that was a big misstep. And then there's this other character, this nurse in the hospital who wanted to be a nun, but she didn't do it because of some reason. But my point is this, you know, I feel like she should have been the monumental character in terms of taking the place of the priest. She should have been the character that we really wanted to succeed, the character that we really kind of got behind in all this. And that never happened. It's like all the characters in this film are under development. And for a film that has a running time for nearly 2 hours, I don't get that. I don't get how there's so little time spent on developing them. And maybe when it's released on home video, there'll be a 3-hour cut, but they really needed to focus on characterization. Now, a lot of people have been saying that's really one of the good things about this film is that it focuses on the characters. And I disagree. I disagree. It doesn't really, it isn't, the time doesn't really work toward endearing these characters. But at any rate, guys, this is just a movie that, as I said, it's just there. It's forgettable. It's mediocre. It's marginal. If you're an Exorcist film fan, would I even say watch this? Probably not. I would just say, you know, it doesn't feel like it's connected really to any of the, it's supposed to be a sequel to the first film, but it doesn't really feel like it is, even with Ellen Burstyn there, because she's just in it so quickly. And why she goes upstairs and acts like she's trying to exorcise the demon from this little kid is beyond me. I mean, she's literally going up there saying, I cast you out, blah, blah, blah. And I'm thinking, the demon should have just said, Who the fuck are you? Do I know you? But anyway, it's just a mess of a movie, man. Just underwhelming. Totally underwhelming. Anyway, you know, it kind of sucks to wrap up my look at the Exorcist franchise with this last film that doesn't really bring the story to a resounding, exploding conclusion, but instead just a little silent whimper. But it's a film that, unfortunately, guys, they just underwritten ideas, interesting ideas, but totally the execution is way off. And not taking advantage of what they were actually trying to say in the story. I mean, it's still better than The Exorcist 2, The Heretic. But it's just unfortunately a waste of time. And there's much better Exorcist films out there. I mean, I just watched one with Russell Crowe. I think it's called The Pope's Exorcist. And that one was pretty damn good. I did enjoy that one. The Nun 2 is a better film than this one. Although it does have problems. But it's better than this one. But, you know, take The Nun 2 with a grain of salt, because it wouldn't take much to be better than this film. So, and I said that was better. So, anyway, thank you all for watching. Take care of yourselves. I hope you all had a wonderful Thanksgiving with family and friends. Be safe, and I'll see you in the next video. Peace.